Mr. President, members of the Board of Governors, graduates, ladies and gentlemen, in recognition for his achievements and his ongoing dedication to his profession and his community, I am pleased to present the 2012 Honorary Degree recipient, Stu Schwartz. Mr. President, could I please ask you to escort Mr. Schwartz into the front of the stage for the formal presentation of honorary degree. Stuart Schwartz, by authority of the Board of Governors and on behalf of President Gillette, Algonquin College is pleased to confer upon you our highest honor, that of an honorary degree. I now call upon Stuntman Stu to deliver the convocation address.
Wow. I have nothing to say after that. But I would like to tweet this. Because I was asked this morning if I would, and I wouldn't be me if I didn't. So I want you all to smile. Here we go. We're going to take a picture. Say cheese! Okay. About to address Algonquin College ACC convocation. Hit tweet. And let's hope the Wi-Fi in here is working. In 3, 2, and 1, the tweet has been sent out. Phil Gaudreau in Algonquin, I expect you to retweet that. President Gillette, members of the faculty, the graduating class, thank you very much for this incredible honor. Under normal circumstances, I'm usually way up top announcing goals and penalties here at Scotiabank Place for Senators games, so it's a treat to be down at ice level with you. It's also scary to imagine that just 15 years ago, I sat exactly where you were. At 23 years old, I thought I knew it all and had everything figured out. Now at 38 years old, with 2 kids and a wife, who's also a fellow Algonquin grad, I realize that I know nothing. My kids have surpassed me on the iPad with Angry Birds, and my wife is constantly sending me text messages at the grocery store so that I won't forget what to buy. And this will happen to many of you, I promise. What I'm here to share with you today is some stories about how your education at Algonquin College is going to prepare you for what lies ahead. I stand before you today as someone who was asked to leave the radio broadcasting program after just one semester in the fall of 94. And President Gillette, you talked about failures. This one was one of epic proportions for me. It was in the fall of 94, and while I thought I had the voice, I had a terrible attitude. My program coordinator at the time, Don Crockford, sat me down in his office and explained that my poor grades, along with my bad attitude, prevented him from allowing me to continue in the next semester, and invited me to re-register into the program in the fall. Devastated, and being away from home for the first time, I switched into the GAS program, or General Arts and Sciences. To be fair, I was only attending courses in GAS so I could keep my face around campus and worked at the old Burt's Bar, which some of the faculty remember. I may have served you it from time to time. During the final week of exams while I was in the GAS program, I thought it would be better to sleep in and not take any of the exams, and received multiple zeros that week. Prior to coming to Algonquin College, I spent 3 years wandering the halls at Dawson College in Montreal and now had 4 years of post-secondary education under my belt with nothing but a few outstanding bar tabs to show for it. Fast forward to the summer of 95, my parents asked me what my plans were for the following year. I remember telling them that I was tired with school. I'm going to go work in bars and try and get a job at that local radio station. My dad said, and I'll never forget this, no problem. But in that case, you can move back home and do that here. I got to be honest with you. After living on my own with roommates for a year, the thought of moving back to Montreal with my folks was scary. Would they allow late-night parties in the house or hallway bowling with beer bottles? Not likely. You can send me a message on Facebook and I'll tell you exactly what that is. The next day, it was late in the fall of 95, and I remember running into Algonquin College and I begged the registrar's office to let me back in. A sympathetic lady named Bonnie, who I served at Burt's Bar, also must have felt sorry for me because she let me back in with one exception. Bonnie said that if I even skipped one class or fell behind, she would find a way to reverse it, and needless to say, I listened. The first class of that fall was radio news writing, and I was also the same class that I met my now wife, Consuelo Bernardi. And I remember thinking at the time, man, that Spanish girl is really cute. Turns out she's Italian, and her friends call her Connie. The 95-96 year was a new beginning for me, and another one of my close classmates from that year is Dan Mellon, who now runs the radio program here at the college. I've formed lifelong friendships with many that have gone through Algonquin College, and hope you will too. And I guarantee that you'll run into someone while doing business who went to Algonquin College. And now, thanks to social networks, it's so much easier to keep in touch. Many people want to get into broadcasting, and when they ask me, how do you do it? The first thing I always tell them is go to Algonquin. I've recommended Algonquin for countless other programs and love watching how this school just keeps growing. I remember in the 90s hearing about all the plans of how Algonquin was going to change, all these buildings that were going to happen, and thinking, wow, I can't wait one day if I have kids for them to go to Algonquin. And Mateo and Isabella, you're going to Algonquin College. I'm filled with pride whenever I host an event and there's Algonquin students there, whether it's on the production side or in the kitchen. While you were at Algonquin, you likely had some excellent teachers along the way that gave you the guidance you needed and advice to help you through the tough times. Even though it took me 3 years to do the 2-year radio program, I wouldn't be standing before you today without the direction of Norm Wright, Don Crockford, Ian Barry, and several others. They made our time at Algonquin memorable, entertaining, and the basics they taught us we use every single day. My motto in life is simple, and you've probably heard this before, but it bears repeating. Chase your dreams, no matter how big or small. Several months ago when I found out about this amazing honor, I dreamed this day would be shared with a silver cup on stage with me by the name of Stanley. Okay, that part didn't happen, but it sure was an entertaining run. Take chances. Follow your gut. When it's all said and done, it's better to be sitting at the retirement home when you're 90 saying, I'm glad I tried as much as I did. I made mistakes along the way, but in the end, I tried a little of this, a little of that. Do what scares you and challenge it head on. As an Algonquin graduate, you're now in the club. You're an ambassador of this school, and I encourage all of you to get involved in your community. Find a cause that connects with you and help them any way you can. The No More Bullies campaign is one that I'm incredibly proud of. What started out as a tweet one day before I took a nap last fall has gone global. This year we spoke to thousands of students and heard enough stories to fill a few textbooks. If you have a moment, please look into our campaign. We're always looking for support at nomorebullies.ca. To close, I asked my social networks for some advice on how I could end the speech. There were many responses. Some I cannot repeat on this stage. But some of the highlights from my Facebook page are, Merle Shacknow Hagerman writes, I'd like to thank the Academy and especially my wonderful wife, Connie. Okay, not the best one. Jack Crocker wrote, experience is the toughest teacher. It gives the exam first and then gives you the lesson. Jack also writes, I'll be watching via webcast. He graduated yesterday, and he says, if you can, give a big shout-out and congrats to Chelsea Gilmore. There you go, Chelsea. On the Magic 100 Morning Show this morning, we asked listeners to write the last line of the speech. Now, here were two that stood out. Bob Urachuk said, if it is to be me, it is up to me. And Pat suggested, your voice today will echo through the wave of time. And since we're at Scotiabank Place, and it's been a couple of months since we've had a Sens game, how about a Sens goal call? What do you say? Here we go. Senator's goal, scored by number 11, your captain, Daniel Alfredson. Assisted by number 19, Jason Spezza. And number 65, Eric Carlson. Jubilee Fine Jewelers Rolex time of the goal, 3:02. Thank you, Algonquin. I will cherish this forever. Have fun tonight, graduates.
Thank you very much, Stu. You have been a terrific ambassador for Algonquin. I'll say one more thing. I think it bears repeating the importance of this time and this moment in this community for efforts like the No More Bullies campaign. For all the good that you do in the community, perhaps this will be your greatest legacy. Thank you.